obviously when Brian Little left Aston Villa, did it ever enter your thoughts that you could be the next Villa manager?
Well, I didn't even know he'd left. I really didn't. I mean, listen, this is 98. There was no social media. The only way you found out stuff really was on the news, on BBC News, on the BBC Radio. You'd get you know, sports updates from time to time. And the day he left was Tuesday the 23rd, I think, of February 1998. We were on the bus. I was at Wickham, manager of Wickham, and we were on the bus going to Bristol to play Bristol Rovers that particular night. And we went into a hotel for tea about 5 o'clock, you know, beans on toast or whatever it was, and just have a pre-match meal and just, you know, kill an hour or so relaxing before the match. And I sat with my team. We were doing okay at Wickham. We were seventh or eighth in the league. And then I got a phone call from Marion Stringer, who was Doug Ellis's secretary. She calls me Johnny, and she was only one of the very few people that called me Johnny. And when I picked up the phone, she said, "Hello, Johnny." I thought, well, that's Marion. What are you doing? Why are you calling me? You know, you're Doug Ellis's secretary. I couldn't work out why she was calling me. So obviously she said, "Have you heard the news?" And I said, "What news? What are you on about?" And I hadn't heard the news, obviously. Anyway, cut a long story short, I found out sort of within an hour that Brian had left. And why are you ringing me? What's this all got to do with me? And I thought at first that I really thought, because I knew Villa were having a tough time. They were 15th or 16th, I think, in the Premier League. I knew things weren't going very well there. And I thought Brian wanted me to come back as a coach. I really thought he wanted me to come back as a coach. But he didn't ask me. He was a bit embarrassed to ask me back. And I thought then, obviously, it had been handed over to someone like Steve Stride to come and get me to come back. And when I spoke to Steve, he said to me, "Have you heard the news?" And I said, "No." I said, "What's happened?" And then he told me that Brian had left. So then I thought, that idea had gone out. Well, if Brian's left, what are you doing? Why do you want to talk to me? And then he told me, he said, "We want you to come back." And I said, "What has?" Well, I still couldn't work out why would you ever want to talk to me about anything? And he said, "We want you to come back." And I said, "Well, what has?" He said, "As manager." And I said, "Oh, for how long?" Thinking it was like, just come back for a couple of weeks until we get somebody decent. So I really did. I really thought, "Oh, you want me to come back for a couple?" I can't, because I'm sort of manager of Wickham. I can't just suddenly come back for a couple of weeks, let you get a manager. And so all these things were going around in my mind. And then I said, "Well, how long?" I actually said to him, "How long for?" And he said, "Forever." And I went, "What is the manager?" And he went, "Yeah." So it was still like it was going over my head. I still could not believe it. I really couldn't believe what I was hearing, and it was unbelievable. And I've got a game to play in a couple of hours' time. So anyway, I go off and I said, "Look, let's speak later. I've got this game. I'm manager of Wickham, and you know my priorities really are to focus on that." Well, could I focus on it? Could I bugger? You know, it's just this thing, and I can't tell anybody. I can't speak to anybody about what's actually happening. And I went home that night, and I'm going to speak at 8 o'clock the next morning. And I can honestly say, sitting here, you know, we've all sort of had sleepless nights when maybe we've managed to grab an hour or 20 minutes, or you're not slept very well or whatever, or you've had a couple. I can honestly say this is the only night ever in my life that I've never had 1 second of sleep. I'm thinking about being the manager of Aston Villa the following morning, and I'm gonna meet the Wickham chairman, and I'm also gonna meet the Aston Villa chairman. And I never slept 1 second that night. I was just awake the whole time, thinking of the consequences, thinking of actually being the manager. And obviously now I think, oh, they've got Liverpool Saturday, and it's like, why can't it be somebody that's not Liverpool, you know? Michael Owen plays for them, you know? So I was, I'd already sort of thought ahead, but I never slept that night at all, really not 1 second. And obviously the next day, I got installed in the following afternoon. February the 25th it was actually, February the 25th. That afternoon at 5 o'clock we had a press meet, press conference in one of the suites at the on the north stand, just underneath there. One of the suites there we had a press conference and it was announced, and it was just a huge, huge shock to me, as it was to everybody else, I think, as well. But it was, you know, I was excited about it, incredibly excited about it, very honoured. And I knew it was a huge, huge job. I mean, obviously, I knew the place. I knew the place inside out. Yeah. I knew everybody. I knew office staff. I knew gate, the guys that worked on the gate. I knew all the stewards. I just knew everybody there. And I obviously came back, and I was just able to put like a comfy pair of old slippers on. You know, just coming back into the place, and I'd never even had a meeting with the players. I used to walk past their dressing room every day and say, don't be late. I always used to shout, don't be late. Because if you were late onto the training field, it was, as a coach, it was my responsibility to find people and make sure I got the money off them, you know. So I can remember, I never even had a meeting with the players because I knew everyone. And I just walked past the room as the manager now. I just said, don't be late, because we started at 10:30, and that was it. And we just went out and got on my training as if I hadn't been away for 16 months, you know. We just got back to work, but obviously we had to get a winning team back on the field. So my first job, this was Thursday afternoon by now. My first training session was in Thursday afternoon. And it went on from there.
Would you have applied for the job, do you reckon?
No, I really, you know, with the greatest of respect, I wouldn't have applied for the job, because I was manager of Wickham. I was very, very happy there. I lived 20 minutes away from the training ground at Wickham. I say training ground, this ground that we rented. You know, little club, wonderful people. I had the best chairman I ever worked for in my life. A guy by the name of Ivor Beeks was my chairman at Wickham. He was unbelievably a fantastic guy. And I was very happy. I just become a father again, you know. My little girl was 3 years old, and everything was great. Everything in my world was great, and I don't think that I would have applied, mainly because I don't think I'd have had a cat and nails chance of getting it. In fact, the Birmingham Mail had a story on the Tuesday night or something. They had a picture on their front page of the 10 contenders for the Villa job, and I wasn't one of them. There was like Ruud Gullit and all these famous managers or ex-managers, and I wasn't one of them. I just wasn't even in the equation. So no, I don't think I would have applied for it. I don't think I would have believed that I had any chance of getting it.
I remember everyone being surprised, and I remember my dad was quite pleased because he reckoned that it all started to go wrong when you left. Yes. But I don't remember being like amazed that you got it. I think people seemed quite kind of pleased about it.
Yeah, I was in the tunnel on Saturday. Obviously, we were playing Liverpool, and I was getting ready to go out to walk along the asphalt, as it was in those days, to the dugout. And it was quite a walk from almost in the corner, wasn't it, in those days, the old stand and the old tunnel. You used to come down those steps. There was like 5 or 6 flights of steps, you know, 50 or 60 steps. And as I'm walking down it, I'm thinking, you know, as I walk out now, I think there might actually be a few boos, you know, from the home fans, you know, and they were all shouting, you know, there'd be a few verbals coming my way, I'm sure. And I wasn't really looking forward to it, I have to say, because I'd not been a European Cup winning player for Villa.
No.
You know, so I wasn't one of those stars. I was a kind of a nobody in many respects. I'd had a couple of years as a player and worked there as a coach, but you know, I was pretty much unknown really to a lot of the Villa fans. And I can remember turning to walk up to the dugout, and I actually got cheered, and I was gobsmacked. And it was as if you know, the Villa fans had sort of gone, well, you're the manager and we're just going to support you. That's it. You've got our trust. You've got everything. We're totally behind you. And I was really overcome by that. I can sense it now, even talking about it now. I can remember the feeling of walking up to the dugout, and it was almost like, oh, I think they quite like me, you know. And I was expecting maybe get things thrown at me and that kind of stuff. So that was very pleasing. And then obviously, as the game unfolded, it got better.
Obviously, the squad you inherited was fairly similar to the one that he'd left behind originally, bar the likes of Stan Collymore, Simon Grayson. Was it just one?
I knew Simon.
Yeah, from Leicester.
From Leicester. I knew Simon very, very well. There was only Stan that I didn't know.
How did that help, the fact you knew them so well previously?
Absolutely. I knew everything about them. I knew what made them tick. I knew the winners. I knew the ones that, you know, would rather miss a leg than miss a match, you know. He just desperately wanted to play. I knew there's something that wasn't quite right. Something wasn't quite right, because it's literally the same people that were here 16 months ago. When I left, they were fourth in the league, you know. We were fourth the year before. We'd won the League Cup. We played in the semi-final of the FA Cup when we lost at Old Trafford to Liverpool. And got some great players. Brian had built himself, you know, as I said earlier, some of the old guard had left, and now we had Brian had replaced them with younger, fitter, stronger players. Not necessarily better players, but really, really good. We had a really good squad, and they worked hard for one another. You know, it was a lot of fight. And I knew that I'd worked with Savo. I knew Savo Milosevic. I knew that he'd been having a bit of a tough season. And obviously Stan wasn't quite living up to the £7 million price tag that we'd paid. But other than that, you know, it was a very talented squad, but something was obviously not happening, and it was up to me to try and find out what it was.
Quite brave team selection in your first game, wasn't it? You went quite all-out attack, really, in that first game.
I knew at the time that you get a bit of licence, obviously, as you come in as a new gaffer. You got a bit of licence. You got a bit of a honeymoon period when you can basically do what you want. And I thought, we've got to win. We've got to start winning games. I mean, we were heading for relegation, and we've got to start winning games. I thought, well, it's Liverpool, the only way that we're going to win. I felt they were a bit suspect. They had some outstanding attacking players, but defensively, they weren't particularly that good, bar Jamie Carragher. They had a guy called Stevie Harkness was playing at the back. Brad Friedel in goal. I think Rob Jones was in the team in those days, and I think there was a young guy called Bjornaby. I'm not sure if he was in the team, but they didn't have a great defence, a great team going forward, but defensively I thought they were, and I just felt that I had the licence really to just go and attack. So I played three strikers. I played Yorkie, Stan and Julian, and we went for it, which is attacked, and played four across the middle, three at the back. Very similar to what Brian had played with three centre halves. I think Ricky Skamaka played.
Yeah.
He played as a right-sided in a three at the back with Skamaka, Gareth Southgate, and Hugo Ekiog at the back. Three defenders. Bozzy obviously in goal. And I just thought, well, we've got to go for it. I've got license to go for it. You know, if it all goes pear-shaped, then it's not too much of a problem. I'll, you know, there's always next week kind of thing, you know. But I had 11 games to keep us up. And I also had a contract that said, if you get relegated this year, you've only got 1 year left to get them back up. And if you don't come straight back up, your contract's finished. That's you, over. So I had, whatever that was, about 15, 16 months of a contract that if it all went pear-shaped, I was gone, you know, without too much compensation. So the first job, of course, was to stay up. And I had 11 games left. And so I had 11 games left really to shape my future career as such, you know. So I knew that I had to win that first game.
9 wins in 11?
Yes.
How did it feel with that first win, though, obviously? Was it relief or jubilation?
Without doubt, relief. Huge relief. A huge relief to win. And I think you can be a little bit selfish, you know, for my own sake, it was very helpful. The fact that I managed to win the game as manager and to beat Liverpool. Liverpool finished third that year, you know. There were no mugs. They were a good football team. And to have beaten them in the way that we did after giving them a goal start was pretty incredible. So there was a huge relief personally on my part. But also there was I think collectively as a group, it was almost like, see what happens when we all sort of club together. And I know there'd been a bit of bitching going on before I got there. There's been a few problems in the dressing room. And there's been a few cliques starting to develop. But we sort of come in and we all worked hard together that particular day and we got a fantastic result. And to be honest, we were playing Atletico Madrid on the Tuesday night and we didn't really have a great deal of time to sort of really enjoy the victory. Although I can remember there used to be a pink evening mail in those days and I can remember the front of it, you know, obviously it was a great big picture and I had my picture took with the pink paper because we'd won. I think Stan had obviously got the headlines. He scored both goals, and it was a great day. You know, I can remember going home, back down south, back down to London, and we all sat and had Chinese and watched Match of the Day. You know, it was, and my little girl, 3 years old, she was on Match of the Day with me that night. So that game will never ever be forgotten in our household. You know, for what it was, and that was the day that I had the most incredible performance from Stanley Collymore. He was just unbelievable, unplayable, unstoppable. He was just, all the stories that I'd heard about him were just so false. And it was, you know, I'd heard he could be moody and there was times in games when, you know, he didn't contribute. Brian had a few problems trying to get him to play. Some weeks, and I've come in, he chased everyone that day. I mean, I know it's his old club and some of them were old teammates of his, but he was unbelievable, unplayable, scored both our goals. We win the game 2-1, he scores them both, one with his right foot, one with his left. I mean, I'd obviously never worked with him before, and I was rubbing my hands at the thought of what a player we've got here. He's just an amazing footballer. Quick, strong, athletic, he was brilliant in the air, you know, he won header after header that day, he chased after fullbacks, he chased back passes to goalkeepers, he put his foot in fact, I ended up taking him off after 77 minutes, because he'd already got a yellow card. Graham Pohl was the referee, he got a yellow card in the first half, Stan, because he'd gone straight through McManaman, and I thought he was getting a little bit overzealous, and I was worried that he'd get another yellow. He was dicing with death a little bit, and I just thought, he scored two goals, let's get him off now, 77 minutes. And the whole of Villa Park stood up that day and applauded him. It was because he'd obviously been a Villa fan as well, but he'd produced the goods. So this was my first look at him, and I just thought, this guy's amazing. What's all this talk about him, you know, not living up to his price tag and all that. This guy had an incredible performance. So I wrongly thought that I'd cracked it. It was me. I thought, you know, I've managed to motivate this guy and get this guy playing. And but it was a truly incredible performance. And that's why I've always said, you know, he was by far the most talented footballer that I ever worked with. By far. He had absolutely everything. And I saw it on that particular day against Liverpool. And I still have the recording of the game, and I very rarely watch it, but on the occasions that I have watched it, it was still stands out to me just what a talent Stan was and the ability that this guy had. And he should have had 100 England caps. Unfortunately, he didn't, but for pure talent, he was far, far and away the most talented footballer I ever worked with. Brilliant. And he got me off to a flyer in my first game.
You touched on it, but obviously then you had Atletico Madrid a few days later. How much of a culture shock was that after 1 minute you're at Wickham, then next thing you know, you're going off to Atletico Madrid to play?
Yeah, we flew out on the Monday, and I just hired Stevie Harrison as my coach. and his first game was going to be Atletico Madrid away. He was the coach of Preston North End Reserves, and he suddenly he's with us on the flight flying out to Madrid to play Atletico Madrid, and I said in my book, I said in that there's a little piece in that I knew two things about Atletico Madrid. One was very little, and the other was nothing. I knew nothing about them. I knew they had a striker called Kiko, and that's basic. You know, when you're playing in League One and your team's in League One, you concern yourselves with League One, and you tend not to be looking at the UEFA Cup and Atletico Madrid. It wasn't really something that, as much as I've followed Villa's opponents, this game against Madrid was completely new for me. So it was pretty daunting, to say the least. And when we got there, I remember driving to the stadium and being showered with stones. You know, the bus got stoned, and this is like, welcome to Atletico Madrid. But we just lost the game 1-0 to a very dubious penalty. But it was, I'd gone from Bristol Rovers on the Tuesday night to the following Tuesday night, Atletico Madrid away. So it was, it was fantastic, but it was very sort of difficult for my mind to kind of accept this huge jump now to European football.
What about the home leg? Because that goes down as like the best atmosphere I've ever witnessed at Villa Park.
Yeah.
We were really, really close that night.
Yes, it was a nearly one. I had quite a few of them during my time. Nearly games where we just nearly did it, nearly won it. That was one of them. And it was an incredible night. They scored very early on, if I remember rightly. Caminero scored for them very early on. So now we've got to make up a two-goal deficit. So we got the win. We've got to score three. We scored two. Stan obviously came on as sub that night and scored an incredible goal. And we had a chance of winning it. I think Molina, the Madrid keeper, made a brilliant save from Lee Hendry very late on. Lee looked like it scored. It was an amazing night, but obviously we didn't win the game, and that rings true to this day. You know, we got very close. It's no point. You might as well not have been in it at all than to have lost at that particular stage. But Brian Little really took a lot of the compliments to get us that far. And then obviously I came in at quarter final stage and messed it up. Which was a shame, really, but no, it was an amazing night, amazing night. It's hard to define who was the best. I mean, I look at it possibly more logically, things like financially, who was the best. Melberg was probably, you know, pound for pound as such. Dean was the worst trainer I ever experienced in my life. Absolute pain in the backside. He'd mess around in training all week, and then something inside of him at 2:30 on a Saturday afternoon, he'd just switch into match mode and he'd focus on the game, and he'd go out and usually be the best player Saturday afternoons. How can we have qualified for the UEFA Cup? We were facing relegation, and everything had sort of fell into place. It didn't feel real, and I sat down some little alleyway and cried my eyes out.
If you enjoyed that video, why not watch another? Click the video choices on screen now to go and watch them in full. Be sure to subscribe to the channel by clicking our logo there on the left. Easy peasy. We'll be right back.